is extravagant. Your friendship, it is intimate. I feel I'm moving to the rhythm of your grace. Your fragrance is intoxicating in a secret place, 'cause your love is extravagant. Spread wide in the arms of Christ, there's a love that covers sin. Captured my heart again. Your love is extravagant. Your friendship, moving to the rhythm of your grace, your fragrance is intoxicating in a secret place, and your love is extravagant. Spread wide in the arms of Christ, cover sin. No greater love have I ever known. You considered me a friend. Spread wide in the arms of Christ, there's a love that covers sin. Capture my heart again. Your love is extravagant. Your friendship, it is intimate.
Walk into the room, everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. And when you walk into the room, every heart starts burning. And nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you. We worship you, oh. We love you. We'll never stop. Can't live without you, Jesus. We love you, and we can't get enough.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. We thank you for your extravagant love. We thank you, Lord, that you just, before we were ever thought of, you loved us. Before we were ever known, you loved us. And Lord, we thank you tonight that we can be here and be in your word and study, Lord, to learn and to get close to you and to get personal with you. Lord, speak to us, Lord, clearly tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. She got me on that one. I've never heard that song before. Powerful words, but I didn't know how to sing it because I never heard it. I didn't know what to do. I'm like, I never heard this. So we went way back into the archives, I think. Dug that one up in the wherever it was. Revelations chapter 9, verse 20. We've talked about some things that took place in this chapter. We started this thing. We talked about the sixth trumpet, the fifth trumpet, sixth trumpet, and you know, and the things that are going to come about from those things that's happening. And now we're in verse 20. Kind of ended last week where he said that everything that happened sounded like it was a report that was mentioned in Malachi 4:1. For Malachi 4:1 says, "For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and the third part of the trees which was burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. That's in Revelation 8:7, kind of goes hand in hand with Malachi 4:1. And then he says, whether the means are natural or supernatural, it's still catastrophic. Whether it's natural or supernatural, either way, it's pretty rough. It's pretty bad. And I believe it's both the natural and the supernatural. Men and demons will be involved in the tribulation woes. Now, what about the remaining 65% of the population? Remember, we had talked about a percent of the population is going to be gone. And you know, so now here's the other 65%. Verse 20 says, and the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, that the ones we just talked about, yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk. Verse 21 goes on and says, neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. We have now witnessed the release of 13 judgments upon the world at this point. Seven seals and six trumpets. We talked about the seven seals earlier. Now we went into the trumpets. One would think that after experiencing such devastation, mankind will begin considering eternity. Wouldn't you think that after all this, these 13 judgments have come, that somewhere on the line now somebody might get the idea that, hey, maybe we need to do something. So, because of everything going on, you know, it looks like, you know, this stuff's coming to an end. We want to make sure we're prepared and ready. Still, they're not doing it. They're not. So, wicked sinners do not give in or give up easily. There are people, let me say this to you clearly, and please catch my heart when I say it. There are people out there that are so set on going to hell, it's going to be hard to convince them otherwise. They've made their mind up. And I know people say, oh, you know, we had a guy here at the memorial service talking about the building stood up because he was in the building. I said, look, that you ain't got to worry about it. This building's never going to fall on your head. Not unless a tornado comes and you're in the building. I said, you are uncomfortable being here. That's why you're thinking it's going to cave in on you. But the point is that there are people that have made their mind up, no matter what you say, no matter what anybody says, no matter what the preacher says, no matter what anybody says, they're not going to give in. They're not going to give up. Wait a minute. I missed a part. He talked about that we would think the devastation would bring them together. Said, those who are still alive continue to rebel. So those that were still here were still continuing to be against God. Look, God's word tells us that men won't repent even after they have been in the regions of the doomed and the damned for centuries. Hell was never created for humans. It was never created for humans. But there had to be a punishment for rejecting Christ. Today, in our society, I've said this to you before, and it's amazing to me that everybody I meet is a Christian. Everybody. Everybody I meet's a Christian. Even the guy that just got through cussing out somebody on the phone. He's born again. He's ready. Because everybody, the reason that's a common answer, because they don't want to hear what you're about to say. Nobody wants to hear about Jesus. You know, Jesus, the name Jesus has always been that attention getter. I told my youth when I was a youth pastor, I said, you sit down and you talk about God all you want. You can talk God, God, God. If you say Jesus, people stop. And if you say Holy Ghost in school, they probably going to put you in a locked up chamber somewhere and think you're stupid. Somebody showed me a picture. Oh, it was my daughter. It said little Johnny had just gotten over the fear of ghosts until the Sunday school teacher started about the Holy Ghost, and he's sitting there just crying his eyes out. But I mean, it's a thing where it's not talked about. You say Jesus in a crowd, people stop and listen because that name still draws attention. But the problem, it's not said enough. It's not mentioned enough. Here we are, people that have been going through these 13 judgments, still are not going to reproach. Even then, they continue gnashing their teeth in expression of their hatred toward God. Listen to this. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and them which do iniquity. And shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Matthew 13, 41 and 42. Exactly. And you hear people say this, well, God's a God of love.
Right.
Well, this is his wrath. This is his judgment coming. God is a God of love. God's had mercy on this nation and other nations. God's had mercy on Israel for how long? He has showed mercy to Israel over and over and over, and he has shown mercy to America over and over and over. Listen, America's done a lot of crazy, stupid things and sinful things, but there's one thing that America's going to answer to God for, and that's killing babies. If it don't, then he better go back and apologize to other nations. God don't have to apologize, because God's going to give the equal wrath of where it needs to fall. Sodom and Gomorrah was a town that was beautiful. It was colorful. It was gorgeous. People would say the sun would come up and would pop off the domes of those buildings. Man, it was just marvelous. But it was full of sin, full of homosexuality. God, what did God do to that place? He destroyed it. He didn't leave nobody. He destroyed it. Because it's an abomination. America's accepted it and welcomed it. Now it's putting it in pulpits behind, or putting it in churches behind pulpits, and asking them to preach the gospel. What gospel? They are. They are. It's called an alternate lifestyle. The Bible says that the demons in hell believe but yet tremble. It's okay to believe he died, but you got to accept that death. You got to apply that death. You got to repent of that life. There's no washing away of your sin if there's no repentance. You know, I read something today on Facebook. It has nothing to do with this teaching. Nothing. But it said this. Maybe on November the 3rd, 2020, maybe we should have repented instead of voted. Because God has never, never messed up with repentance. He's always honored repentance. Maybe we should have repented instead of voted. I don't know. But the point is this. And I'm just saying that, no, we need to vote. We should have voted, and if you did, you did your right thing. But that's, Debbie's right. Ken's right. People have their own idea of what it takes to get to heaven, because they've heard there's so many different ways. But when Jesus said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. And here, we got these people that's left on earth that's been going through all of these judgments, all of these terrible things happening. Now, part of the world's gone. They're like 65% of the world's left, and they're still denying God. Verses 20 and 21 present five major sins which permeate the tribulation, the scene of the tribulation, and for which men would rather die than switch. One is occultism. I'm going to give them all five. We're going to cover all five of these. One is occultism. Two is murder. Three is drug abuse. Boy, that hits home. Been there. Done that and was delivered. Hallelujah. Four is fornication, sexual orgies. Five is stealing. Now we're going to look at these, all five of these further. And I'm not trying to say this to emphasize that the world got bad here, but let me tell you something. In the early church, they preached it from the pulpit that living together was a sin. Today we condone it. And look what it's got us to. Look what it's led us to. Not only have we said, okay, well, y'all can live together, y'all love each other. Now it's man and man and woman and woman. It's migrated from that to where it is today. And I'm not saying that was the catapult for it. I'm just telling you that the things that the church used to preach against and was wrong has now accepted and adopted into their churches.
That song's probably about 40 years old, 30, 40 years old. But you go back to that time, 70s, 80s, that's the way it was.
Yeah.
Everything, you know, church was reverence. People were there. Now, whether they got anything out of it, but everything was closed because they honored. And now, it's just got to be where it's just any old day. It's another day, no big deal. You know,
People go to church so they can feel good about themselves. Because they can go to work on Monday and brag. I was at church yesterday. Really? What about Friday and Saturday when you're at the bar with me? It's become now where church is just a place to go to people. We got our thing worked out. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
You know, you can go to the club, like you said, on Friday and Saturday nights. Sunday, you're okay. You're in church. And then Monday, you're right back doing.
We people have made church for them.
Right.
I mean, they've. This is my idea of church. I'm going to get up, I'm going to go Sunday, I'm going to leave, and then I'm done. And now we put it on Facebook Live, so now they ain't got to leave their home, and they go to church. So I'm not knocking live stream. We're doing it right now. Hey, Facebook family, we're doing it right now. And we've been doing it before the pandemic came. And I just thought it was something great and cool. We had the technology, we had the equipment. Let's put it out there so somebody in Tennessee, somebody in Kentucky, somebody in Alabama, whatever, can watch us and get something. Maybe they're not able to, maybe there's no churches over there, or maybe they just want to hear something else. So it's a beautiful thing. But it's become so convenient for some people. Nobody that I know personally, but I'm just telling you, it's become convenient for a lot of people that I wonder if some of those people will ever darken the door of a church again.
Well, you know, you can watch it. You can watch it and not feel anything. So you have no guilt. It's like, yeah, I was there, and that's it.
See, no. People drove sometimes for an hour to go to church. And they'd stay, go to church, go home, eat, and drive back. And then go on midweek service. revivals back then, I'm telling my age, they wasn't Sunday to Wednesday, they were Sunday to Sunday. They were scheduled Sunday to Sunday, and sometimes they went to the next Sunday. There was tent revivals, there was brush harbors, there was listen, and I'm not trying to get them, give me that old time. I'm not trying to go there. I love that song. I don't want it to do with religion. I can't stand religion. I want a relationship with Jesus because that's where it's founded. I mean, I love Pentecost. I love Pentecost. I grew up in it. I was cut my teeth on it. I was raised in it. It's all I know. Is it better than anybody else? No, but I just love the benefits that it has with it. There's something about the Holy Spirit. It's just something about it. But I remember churches coming together and doing ministry as a community, and nobody was worried about nobody. Now, don't go over there because you may like that church better than mine, and you might leave me, Steve. Please don't go over there. If you got a revival somewhere, go hit it and get it, and it'll get hot and come back. What about the home prayer meetings they used to have? But see, now they're home gossip sessions. You know, they eat snacks and drink drinks, and they talk about other people in the church. Well, I said now. They used to say, okay, we're going to go to the Gibson's house next Tuesday, y'all, at 6 o'clock. We're going to go, and we're going to pray. And I don't mean we went over there and we talked for 35, 45 minutes. Well, I mean, we got there, and when you walked in, they were already praying. So you found your spot and you prayed, and sometimes it was dark, pitch black, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night before you go home. But see now, and there's nothing wrong with still having it. We can have a prayer meeting here and go over there and eat all you want. We can go have hot wings. I don't care. I love hot wings. I can eat hot wings and pray. Trust me. But what I'm telling you is the focus is not on the prayer, it's on the meal after the prayer. So we shorten the prayer time so we can make the eating time longer. And believe me, look at me, I don't mind eating, y'all know this. So I'm not belittling, I'm just telling you, it's changed. So we talked about occultism. This is the first sin that he's talking about in these two verses. Listen to this first statement about the occultism. The tribulation will be a time of pronounced devil worship. Did you hear that? Anton LaVey. Everybody heard of him? Anton LaVey began the Church of Satan movement in San Francisco. Estimates reveal that tens of thousands in California alone are connected to this or some other type of occult organization. He is the founder of the Satanic Church. They have rituals. They have seances. They worship the devil. It's so real. It's so real. And it's so right now in our back door. It's so right now in the city of Griffin. I promise you, there's satanic worship going on. Why? Because it's being under attack. Anytime you're going to invite the devil somewhere, you're going to bring chaos and havoc and terrible times. That's why the Holy Spirit needs to be in us and working through us, because that is the only defeat of this stuff. It's the only thing.
Thank you.
Stores where satanic objects may be purchased are presently springing up everywhere, nationally and internationally. God hates this sin. Demonic worship probably is... See, listen to what he said. Regard not them that have familiar spirits, neither seek after wizards to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. In Leviticus. And the soul that turneth after such as a familiar spirit and after wizards to go to a whoring after them, I will even set my face against that soul and will cut him off from among his people. Again in Leviticus. Anything that smacks of demonic related practices has the anathema of God upon it. Look at the listings found in Deuteronomy 18:10 through 12. There shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that useth divination, or observer of the times, astrology, or as an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with the familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a... Who? Yes. See? For all those things are abomination unto the Lord. An abomination unto the Lord. God never hates people, but he hates that stuff. It almost makes him sick like the lukewarm church does. Actually, it probably does to a point. It's an abomination to him. Listen. I have a book in my office that I've read it several times, and I just kind of revisit it sometimes. But the title of the book is Witchcraft in the Church. I saw the title, I'm like, eh. I shouldn't read this. I'm glad I read it because I've experienced it. Witchcraft in the church. America is trying to be set up for what you want to call it, but it's going to be set up to be demonic. You call it whatever, socialism, whatever you want to call it, you know, whatever. But I'm telling you, the forces at our hand are so demonic and so strong and so powerful that if the church doesn't get herself together, we're going to lose this nation. This is occultism. This is all occult. Listen, there are people that are in so many religions. That's why I don't like the word religion. Jehovah's Witness is a cult. If you've got family in it, I'm sorry, but it's a cult. It's not Bible. It's not scriptural. It's a cult. Anytime there's a bunch of do's and don'ts, oh, there's do's and don'ts in the Bible, but it's not a ritual where you have to, a standard you have to go by. There's one standard, and that's the standard of God. This is occultism. And you remember what I said at the very beginning. It's a time of pronounced devil worship. That's what it is. That's all it is. Okay. And then he says, in addition to worshiping devils, earth dwellers of the tribulation hour also use idols made of gold, silver, brass, stone, and wood. The saddest story in the Bible to me is the children of Israel. When they were set free from Egypt, they were in bondage. They went in there and they were slaves and they worked them hard and they set them free. And as they were setting them free, they gave them gold and silver and brass and things. And they left wealthy people and they got to the wilderness and they sat there and they rebuked God and they denied God and they built an idol made out of the same thing that God blessed them with. And they worshiped it. We're going to build an idol. We're going to make a golden calf. And that's going to be our God because they worshiped it. Anything you worship is your God. So, God hates idolatry. He hates idolatry. This practice breaks his holy law, the second commandment given to Moses in Exodus 24 and 5. Says, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God. He don't want to share you with nobody. He's not jealous to a extent of sinful. He's jealous to a extent of there's no other God but him. People today worship everything but God. There are those today who knowingly and unknowingly break God's commandment by worshiping lifeless, man-made idols. Their worship, however, is meaningless to God. It doesn't mean anything. It carries nothing. It doesn't get them anywhere. It doesn't do anything for them. The psalmist says in Psalms 115, verses 4 through 8, their idols are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they speak not. Eyes they have, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. Noses they have, but they smell not. They have hands, but they handle not. Feet, but they walk not. Neither speak through them their throat. They that make them are like unto them, helpless and hopeless. And so is everyone that trusts in them. God condemns idolatry, past, present, and future. He is not going to accept your idols. During the tribulation hour, the world stepped in occultism and idolatry. It progresses to the worship of the image of the beast or the Antichrist who proclaims himself as God. 2 Thessalonians 2:4. I told you several weeks ago that I got an article from the Palestinian leader of the Palestinian group that the Jews are trying now to get the permission to start erecting a temple on the Dome of the Rock. That's scriptural. That's where the Antichrist will set up his seat on the seat of David and claim to be the Messiah. He can't do it till that temple's built. Don't know when they're going to start it. Don't know when they're going to finish it. But I just want to know that they're building it. That's all I care about. The image made in his likeness, Revelations 13, 15, a lot of this stuff is ahead of us, but is undoubtedly the abomination of desolation that Jesus spoke about in Matthew 24, 15, which is placed in the temple in Jerusalem and which brings great heartache to the Jews of that day. One can see that the world's present surge of occultism is paving the way for the coming of the greatest religious imposter in history. The Antichrist is a fake and a phony. That's why it's called anti. This stuff that's taking place, this devil worship, has already been set before us. It's already taking place now. You've heard it from Debbie. You've heard it from others. It's not nothing. It's just going to happen. It's just going to elevate to a new level at this time. And people, you know, for a long time, demonic worship and devil worship and stuff like that was kind of under the radar. They were proud of who they were, but they didn't want you to know it. But now they don't care. It's almost like the saying that I told you that Satan now is walking around right in front of everybody, and the church don't even see him. Not some churches. So, this is some very serious stuff that's taking place. occultism, devil worship, Satan worship. It's going to prevail and be prominent in this time of the tribulation. Now we talk about murder. During the same time, murder becomes a sport, and judgment does not change the situation. They kill for the joy. It's a sport. It's like deer hunting. It's just a game. The wicked refuse to turn from their brutalistic manner of living. They find pleasure in killing people, perhaps because terrorism is rampant. Jesus said, but as the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of Son of Man be. Noah's day was characterized by violence. Remember that? The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. Our 21st century is certainly leading in this terrifying hour. Where we are now is leading. Violence, all this stuff was taking place. God had to say, you know what, Noah, build this ark, please. I'm going to send some rain, and I'm going to wipe out all these people. Because there's heart, they're violent, and their hearts are darkened. I got to get rid of them. And he did. And he's going to do it again at this time. You know, God got so frustrated with Israel, he finally told Moses after he completed with him, "Your my people, my people, my people," he finally said, "Moses, your people." And I always cackle when I read that because God got to the point where he was so fed up with people, he said, "They're not even mine anymore. I give them to you. You do what you want to with them." Wow. That's pretty at a bad point when God says, "I'm done with you." We know he's not. We know that he's still... they're his chosen generation. They're his chosen nation. But still, they're rebellious. They're a rebellion heart. They're turned their heart against him. Same here. I mean, it said people kill just because terrorism is rampant. It's killing daily. I know it's bad now, but what do you think this is going to be like? The next is drugs, fornication, and stealing. There's three of them. It's the lengthiest of all of them because it's covering all three. The final three sins prevalent during the end times are accelerated and have to do with sorceries. Drug abuse, fornication, the practice of every one conceivable sex sin, and theft. These sins indicate that bodies are being sold through prostitution, and burglaries are being committed in order to support the drug kick. Present news headlines indicate that this day is already dawning. There's sex trafficking going on right now, and Atlanta is one of the biggest hubs for it. Kids, children sold into prostitution, sold into sex slaves, sold into it. Young girls having no say-so. Drugs are inhabited in every county, every state, in Georgia and in every other state around. Yeah, there's some that's not as bad as others, but I'm telling you, drugs are everywhere. When I left this town to move to Florida, I was an addict, I was addicted, and I'm telling you, when I moved to Florida, the first 3 days I was there, I found every dealer I needed. Because I didn't have to look for them, they found me. When you're an addict, you ain't got to find it. It'll track you down, trust me. And it's continued. When I moved up here, moved back to Clayton County, met my wife, we were dating, I still the same thing. I found everybody I needed to find to do what I needed to do. Drugs, It's prevalent. It's everywhere. It's in the news every day. Surely our time as the church upon earth is about to end, and we must prepare to meet our God. Amos 4:12. It's time that we get prepared, church. In concluding this chapter, we're going to spend time on the matter of drugs. There are a number of words used in the Bible to describe the subject of sorcery. Never tied drugs with sorcery, but I can understand how they can relate. Because you see things. Hallucinations are real in the drug world. And you dream dreams, but they're not good dreams from God. I promise you that. Altogether, there are at least 27 references to sorcery. Sorceries, witches, witchcrafts, and the art of bewitching. Of these, at least five in the New Testament are especially important, for they have a direct bearing on the day in which we live, the present day of drugs and drug addiction. In the books of the Old Testament and the book of Acts, the term sorcery always means witchcraft or magic. You remember when Peter and Simon the sorcerer wanted to buy the Holy Spirit and he cursed him? It was witchcraft and magic. And one should note that the practice is continually and constantly condemned. Five occurrences in the word sorcery in the New Testament, however, have to do with drug addiction. In these instances, the original Greek word is pharmakia, which is where we get our word pharmacy or drugstore from. That's the Greek word, is pharmakia. Okay? We get our word pharmacy or drugstore. The literal meaning of the Greek is an enchantment with drugs, or to get high on or get a kick out of drugs. This is just... Ooh, thank you, God, for deliverance. Medications prescribed by doctors are not part of this condemnation. Okay? But, don't get me wrong, people get addicted to pain pills. People abuse pain pills. The literal rendering of verse 21 then is men that repent not of their enchantment with drugs during the tribulation hour. Each of the five references must be carefully considered in the light of its context. Collectively, they clearly reveal this. Number one, the present world condition as foretold in the prophetic scriptures. It's just foretold. Number two, the inevitable result of drug addictions. Number three, the certain and definite judgment upon the drug pusher as well. Number four, the drug victim. And finally, the appraisal of this terrible sin in the sight of God Almighty. As previously stated, we can only see the dawning of the day of drugs and the spread of drug use throughout all levels of society. And when these notes these notes and all were put together, some stuff I'm giving you of my own, but I'm reading the commentary on Revelation. When it was written, I guarantee it's escalated probably 1,000 times, if not more, from this point. Such a widespread of use of drugs cannot be helped but bring its own destruction. It doesn't matter. They're going to bring their own destruction on your life, but you're still going to have to answer for this. Even amid of all the trips of the mind expansion propaganda, not one user has ever been able to actually do more or be more efficient than he was before experiencing it with drugs. Do you know, I literally thought I was invincible. Can't bother me. Can't hurt me. Mm-mm. I'll get to a place where I get so high, you don't want to be around me. I'll terrify you. I'm invincible. I probably said that to myself, I don't know how many times. See, I was, but I didn't realize the Holy Spirit was protecting me. Because he had a plan. See, this steady downward efficient, this steady downward retrogression will be climaxed at the close of the Great Tribulation when the full cup of his own judgment is measured. Did you realize that this was going to be part of the Great Tribulation? When you read this chapter and these verses of Revelations, did you realize the emphasis that's putting on drug use? Can you imagine what it's going to be like then? Everything's going to escalate. Everything's going to be increased. The closing chapters of the book of Revelation graphically portray the terrible consequences of mankind's enchantment with drugs. What are we presently witnessing? What we are presently witnessing is only the beginning and the coming of society, of the becoming of a degeneration of society during this tribulation time. Revelation 18:23 says, For the sorceries were all nations deceived. The Greek word for sorceries is still pharmakia. By their enchantment with drugs or getting high on drugs were all nations deceived. This is the result of mankind's first mass usage of drugs. Now there's a change in the next occurrence of the world translated sorcerers. This change reveals a class of people who are doomed and is found in the chapter 21, verse 8. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers, whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death.
How about caffeine?
What about it? If you abuse it, can you abuse it? How? Don't tell me you drink too much, because I drank Coke for a long time. Caffeine's not a drug.
When we were young, we used to get something called crosses. They were little pills, and they're supposed to have a lot of caffeine in them. And we used them for staying up all night and
dying. That's probably a borderline there, but I mean like coffee, tea, and soda and drinks. You can overindulge in a lot of things, but you know, you can be an addict to anything besides a drug, and it becomes like a drug to you. I mean, when you're an addict, it means that you are addicted to something that you can't live without. At least that's what your mind tells you. Go to something that's pretty common, pornography. It's a drug. It's not nothing you take physically by a needle or by smoking it or by popping it, but it's something that gets into your mind and into your spirit, and it becomes a lust factor, which means you're sinning every time it's viewed, and it becomes addictive. There's a lot of different ways to look at it. I wouldn't consider caffeine, drinks with caffeine would be in this category. This is a category that's far beyond what we could ever imagine, probably. Well, it is. There's no doubt about it. The Greek word for sorcerer is the same thing that I just said. Listen, it's not only going to be the users, it's going to be the pushers and the seller of drugs as well. This text plainly declares the eight distinct groups of people who will never get into heaven, but will rather be assigned to the lake of fire, a description of a literal hell. One of these groups is composed by those who are enchanters or pushers of drugs. What solemn warning against having anything to do with the soul-damning drug traffic at the present hour. I'm going to stop right there. I'll finish this next week. It's just a few more paragraphs, but it's about 2 minutes till. And then we'll jump into chapter 10. I know this has been kind of lengthy. It's been a lot of reading I had to do because there was just too much to try to. Basically, we've come to the point where there's occults going to be taking place during this time. There's murder. It's going to be taking place. There's drugs, fornication, and stealing. It's going to be taking place. It's going to be. It's going to be probably. The most difficult time on earth ever.
The magic and cartoons and like Harry Potter books and such like.
Harry Potter sorcery. Probably. There's got to be a gateway for something. There's got to be an opening for something. Children go by a learned behavior. You know, if it's been said that if, you know, children, they watch what's around them. They hear what's around them. We had a situation where there was somebody that was into Harry Potter, and I was like, no, not in this place, not in this house. But I can use it for illustration. I said, not in this house. Harry Potter is sorcery. It's witchcraft. You know, we got to be very careful how we look at this, because to be honest with you, a lot of people turn their nose up. If I ever get on the subject talking to someone, I get looked at, even probably made fun of. But see, people don't understand that there's things that go on in the church realm that's full of witchcraft, which is gossip. It's a form of witchcraft. It's all these things that. They're from the demonic world, and it's people think, oh, witchcraft, they think of seances and casting spells. You know, listen, I had a lady. This is funny. It's not funny. It's sad, but it's funny. We had a Coke machine here at the church, and it was downstairs. It worked. The youth was going to use it for fundraiser, but you know, they never did, but it worked. And one day we was doing a cleaning, so I put it on Facebook. I took a picture, stuck it out there. I get a lady that messaged me. I'm interested in the Coke machine. I said, oh, great, wonderful. Well, how much is it? She said, I saw, is that price firm? I said, yeah, it is. I said, you know, it's actually probably worth a little more, but I'm not trying to break the bank. I just need it out of my way. And I said, I know it's worth some money. It'll do somebody some good. You can make money off of it in time. But she said, well, I live in such and such place. Can you ship it? And I said, no way. I can't ship it to you. I said, I don't have the resources or the funds to do that. Now, if you want to pay for it to be picked up, I'm all for it. I said, but what I'll need from you is a letter that you're going to buy it as is, signed and dated, whatever. And I'll need your payment up front. Well, I ain't doing that. I ain't even seen the home. I said, well, you're buying it from a church. Well, churches will rip you off. I said, not this one. And she said, and she went on through this, and I said, listen, better yet, I'll just keep it and I'll sell it to somebody locally. I think it'd be better. Boy, I got a curse sent to me. I have cursed you. I've cursed your house. I've cursed your family. I've cursed your church. Everything, anything bad is going to happen. Anything terrible is going to. Oh, I've put this spell on you. And I'm like, really? This was in a message, you know. I wish it had been on the phone, but I said, really? You know, with the exclamation points, like I'm scared. And she's like, yes. And, you know, and I said, well, how much time do I have? She says, what do you mean? I said, when's it going to take effect? Oh, it's going to take effect probably immediately. Or within the next few hours, you're going to start feeling it. It's been 10 years ago.
Yeah.
I ain't felt nothing. And I told her finally, I said, listen, you can cast all spells you want. You can put spells on me. You can put curses on me. I said, I'm going to tell you something, dear. They can't cross the blood of Jesus. And she said, Jesus, ain't nothing to do with Jesus. I said, oh, it's everything to do with Jesus. And matter of fact, if you knew him, you probably wouldn't be talking to me like this. Oh, I know who he is. I said, yeah, that's a problem. You know who he is. You ain't experienced him. So I did it in love. I said, I'll pray for you. I got your name. I'm going to pray for you. I said, but, you know, and she said, you're still, you're cursed. You got a spell. I said, okay. That following Saturday, a lady pulled up. We had stuff around back. She pulled up. She looked at the Coke machine. She goes, yeah, I'll buy it. Took it, put it on the trailer, and drove off with it. And I said, before she left, I said, why do you want to buy a Coke machine? She goes, listen, my neighborhood, I have two teenage boys, and every one of those boys in the neighborhood come to my house and drink my drinks. Now they're going to have to buy them. She says, I'm putting it on my back porch. I'm filling it full of their favorite drinks. And if they want to buy it, they can put 50 cents in the machine. They can get one. They ain't going to be drinking my stuff anymore. And I said, okay, that's kind of smart. She goes, I also found me a vending machine, and I got snacks in it. And the same thing applies for that. She says, I ain't going to feed this whole neighborhood because I can't, because these boys eat like horses. But, you know, and that's what I'm trying to say is that... She got so upset, she's going to bring a curse. And it's just witchcraft. It's not just people casting spells or doing seances. I mean, it's just sitting at home or going to the restaurant after church and your meal is the pastor. Because you're chewing him up, spitting him out. It's gossip. It's witchcraft. It's demonic. And you won't go to heaven if you do it. I'm sorry. You have to repent from that and move past that and get forgiven from that. I forgot about, you know, like I said, I haven't studied Revelations really deep, and I did not realize the depth that it got into with the drug abuse and stuff. I knew that Greek word, but I never tied all that together, and it's just mind-boggling to me that that's going to be one of the culprits. And the end of the world is drug abuse. It has drug. You know, listen, my siblings grew up in the 50s and stuff, and you know, there was alcohol. There was probably drugs there, but you didn't hear about it. You know, my mom and dad. My mom was 42 when I was born, and so Elaine moved out when she was 21. So, you know, we were only in the house. You know. She was 16, so we was only in the house 5 years together, and it was just me and mom and dad. And but through my life growing up, and me finding getting on the drug side of things, my mom has went in my room and found marijuana in my and not know what it was. My dad found it in my car. He pulled my sun visor down and it fell on his lap. And he goes, "You need to quit chewing this tobacco," and handed it to me. I was like, "Yes, sir," you know. But because they were older, they didn't have to go through that. I'm ashamed that I put my parents through that. I'm really ashamed about it, you know. And I laugh about it now because, you know, they didn't know. But I did come home one day and she was flushing something down the garbage disposal, and she didn't know how much money it was worth. And I said, Mom, I got to pay for that. Nope, I don't care. You ain't pay for it with my money. It's like, okay. But the point is this, is that, you know, they didn't have to experience that stuff, but it was around back then. It just wasn't as evident. And then here I am these many years later, and it's out front. Now look at it. It's everywhere. You, if you're an addict, you ain't got to worry about getting high because you'll be able to. I mean, it's now they're legalizing the you know, the cannabis oil. Oh, well, it don't get you high. Then why are you taking it? What's the purpose if it ain't going to do an effect to you? Why are you taking it? Listen, everything's become easy now. The church is, Steve said it, we're almost forced. We're almost forced to accept this stuff. What I just read to you tonight says we can't accept it. This is going to be an end time thing that's going to be rough and hard. So my statement to you is to be ready now. Don't try to get ready then. Don't try to prepare then. Be prepared now. We're in the time for the church. And Sunday's message that I'm bringing to you Sunday is probably it's probably familiar scripture. I've preached on it before, but we're going to elaborate on a part of it because I believe it's what it's being called right now. I believe it's what's being said from heaven right now to the church. And I believe it's in my spirit what the Lord spoke to me. I haven't finished the message. I'm still preparing it. But what I feel I'm receiving is that it's desperate that we get to this point. And I'm not going to tell you what it is. You have to be here Sunday to find out. You have to come. But I will say this. I heard a statement made. And I have to believe this statement, that everything that's been going on, it's not been about an election. It's been about a move of God. And I just have to believe that statement. It hasn't been about an election or anything. It hasn't been about social injustice. It hasn't been about illegal stuff or fraud. It's been about a move of God. I think God positioned the church, or let the church get in a position to where she could do nothing but run after him. And I believe that's where we are. Pastor, what do you think is going to happen? I have people ask me, what do you think is going to happen down the road? I don't know. I ain't God. I can't figure it out. He ain't told me yet. All I do is trust him. You think, what if the world goes crazy? I said, then we'll live in a crazy world. It's already crazy. I know it's going to get worse, but I said, we'll live in a crazy world. Well, what if it gets to the point where we can't take it? I said, then he'll come get us. If it gets so bad, he'll get us out of here. I don't think God's going to let his church suffer to the point where they're not going to make it. We're going to suffer. We're going to go through things we already have. Has anybody not suffered? Let me see your hand. Anybody not been through suffering? Okay. I was going to say, if you haven't, hold on. It's coming. Because Jesus said we would. But the point is that where is my faith lying? Where is my confidence? Where is my trust? What is my hope? My hope is called the blessed hope. And he's coming soon. And I believe every day I wake up, I'm like, oh, wow, we're one day closer. We're one day closer. I don't know. I've heard prophecies, predictions. And you know what? Some of them really got me going. Woo, man, woo. Some of them I'm like, I don't know. But the point of it is that regardless of either side, the bad ones are the real ones. Either way, God is still the one in control. And God's going to be the one that's going to have to bring forth his word. Let's stand. Father, we thank you tonight for your word. God, I pray that it helps. I pray that it encourages us. I pray that, God, it takes root in us, that we'll be able to. Lord, we're not going to have to experience these things, but, Lord, we know there may be people out there we know that might. And I know, Lord, help us be able to share with them your saving grace, your salvation, your plan for their life. God, help us. And let this book that we're learning, Lord, let it be just an instrument that we can use to forewarn people of the times that are ahead if they're not prepared. Father, thank you for these that are here tonight. Bless them as they go home. Lord, bring us back Saturday as we come to do Brown Bag Ministry. We ask you to put your hands all over that ministry, to put your anointing all over that ministry. God, that we don't go out the walls of this church with a mindset of just to be noticed, but God giving out sandwiches, but we go out the door with a mindset that somebody's going to find and encounter Jesus. Because that's what it's about, God. That's what it's all about. We thank you for the opportunity to serve this community in this capacity. And Lord, we pray for Sunday as we come in to worship you in spirit and truth. Bless your people in Jesus' name. Amen.